So I'm going to be talking for the next hour and 15 minutes on all things hematology and some stuff oncology as well as we go through. Now, we're going to start off by looking at anemia. And definitions are pretty self-explanatory. Basically, there are two standard deviations below the mean of apparently healthy adults, which is how almost all, quote, normal or abnormal labs are actually defined. For children, and this is going to be covered more in the PED section, there are some age-specific hemoglobins up until about the age of 18 or so. And the U.S. Preventive Services does pipe in with a couple of recommendations related to iron deficiency. The first one is to supplement iron in premature and low birth weight children between the ages of 6 and 12 months. And secondly is to screen pregnant women for iron deficiency. They go on to say that there's insufficient evidence for routine screening in otherwise asymptomatic patients. Now, when trying to classify the anemia, there's two ways to do this. One is the cause, and the other one is the morphology. And the morphology is coming up in the next slide or two, and is probably the more common one that we learned during medical school. Anemia can, of course, be due to lack of food, if you will, lack of nutrients, iron deficiency, B12, folate, and the like. It can be a manifestation of either a primary or an extrinsic effect on the bone marrow. The primary bone marrow involvement, of course, are the ones listed up here, such as aplastic anemia, myelodysplasia, and then there are, of course, hormones such as erythropoietin, which is typically low in chronic renal failure. Thyroid has some effect on the development and production of red blood cells, as does testosterone. So just recognize you can either have intrinsic or extrinsic effects on the bone marrow that may affect the synthesis of the red cells. In addition, you can have destruction, of course, which is hemolytic anemia, which is coming up in the next couple of slides, not the next ones immediately after this, but in about 10 slides or so, we'll be having several slides on hemolytic anemia. But just as a nice category, I think it's important to recognize that these can be inherited causes, such as spherocytosis, thalassemia, and the like, and acquired, such as Coombs positive autoimmune hemolytic anemia. And here's one of these don't be fooled elements. When people are on Coumadin, they can bleed into sites that are not easily recognized. So if you have a question on the test where a patient comes in, they're on an anticoagulant, and all of a sudden it appears that they're bleeding, but they're not puking blood or passing blood in their stool and there's no obvious site, recognize the retroperitoneum in the deep thigh can really accommodate a whole lot of blood, and patients may look like they've got a blood loss anemia, but it's not apparent. So just recognize the connection between Coumadin and the bleeding in the retroperitoneum in the upper thigh. Now the second major category, which is probably one that we're most used to thinking about, is based upon the size of the red cells. If you get a photomicrograph on the examination that shows you a smear of a red smear of red blood cells, look for the lymphocyte, okay? Because I think what they may be testing you on is that the size of a normal mature RBC is the same size as a lymphocyte nucleus. So I can tell you it's not uncommon for many tests for them to actually test whether you recognize that connection and show you cells that might be smaller than or larger than a lymphocyte nucleus so that you can perhaps make the diagnosis. So that's a kind of an important point if you get a photomicrograph on the examination. The microcytic is less than 80. Normocytic, of course, is 80 to 100. Macrocytic is greater than 100 with issues such as reticulocytosis, the ones we always think about, B12, folate, myelodysplasia, alcoholism, liver disease, and the like. And here's a fun fact to know and tell at your next cocktail party, is a femtoliter is 10 to the minus 15 liters. So store that useless information away. Now, when you're looking at microcytic anemia, it's basically due to decreased hemoglobin content in the red cells. We are all used to thinking about iron as the cause of microcytic anemia, and indeed, iron leads to decreased hemoglobin content in the red cells. But also, decreasing heme synthesis, as you might see with thalassemia, also leads to decreased hemoglobin content in red cells, as does decreased globin production, as you might see heme synthesis with sideroblastic and globin production with thalassemia, as listed up here. You can use your serum iron, TIBC, and ferritin. to help differentiate whether or not there's a problem with the substrate, whether there's a problem with globin synthesis or heme synthesis by kind of using a compare and contrast between your serum iron, TIBC, and ferritin. In addition, lead poisoning, which is could be a rare cause of decreased heme synthesis in children, so you need to think about that as a possibility as well. Now, with regards to iron deficiency anemia, of course, blood loss is by far and away the most common cause in the United States. Other causes include pregnancy and infancy, secondary to increased iron needs. I'm not sure 50% of the time it's associated with pica. I remember walking into my office a number of years ago, and my secretary is just chomping down the ice. And she said, I just can't get enough of this stuff. And I said, you should get your iron checked in. And indeed, she was iron deficient. So pica does occur with iron deficiency. Now, the most sensitive test for identifying iron deficiency will be your ferritin. The normal level is listed up here as 40 to 200. And here's a don't be fooled element that I like to point out occasionally. Remember that ferritin is also an acute phase reactant. So if you have somebody who is ill or has an inflammatory process going on, you would expect the ferritin to be high. And indeed, somebody may be iron deficient, but it's not going to be reflected in the ferritin because of the fact that it is an acute phase reactant. So just recognize that as a caveat or an asterisk, if you will, when it comes to this idea of using ferritin for iron deficiency anemia. Also, if it's less than 15, there's almost 100% specificity for iron deficiency. Greater than 100, essentially, and again, there's always some caveats, but essentially, iron deficiency is ruled out when somebody, again, is in their steady state and not having an inflammatory process going on. In terms of the transferrin saturation index, so if your ferritin is not helpful in terms of making a diagnosis, you're going to order your iron and TIBC. Putting your transferrin saturation index, which is simply iron over the TIBC times 100, if it's less than 5%, it is highly consistent with iron deficiency. Normal would be 25 to 45%, and I got a couple of slides later, we'll be talking about hemochromatosis. If the iron saturation is actually elevated, that is consistent with the possibility of hemochromatosis. If that's not helpful, then there's a final serological test that you can order called the soluble transferrin receptor, which is inversely related to iron stores. So you'd expect that to be elevated in somebody who has iron deficiency. Now, in terms of treating iron deficiency, few iron preparations have any advantage over ferrous sulfate. You would expect the hemoglobin to start to rise within 2 to 3 to 4 weeks, and you would expect a fairly brisk reticulocytosis within a week or so when patients are adequately replaced. And I think we're all aware and have been taught a lot in medical school and residency, it takes a while to replace the body's stores, up to 6 months or so. Now here's another caveat, and that is, in the presence of atrophic gastritis, celiac disease, H. pylori, and perhaps some other conditions as well, iron is not well absorbed. So patients could be taking all the iron in the world and they may not get this type of response that you're looking for. So again, don't be fooled in some situations. If indeed patients do have iron deficiency, they don't get the brisk response you're looking for, you need to look at the possibility that they just can't absorb it. And there's a quick and easy test that you can do. I almost consider it the equivalent of a glucose tolerance test. This is an oral iron tolerance test. That you give you order a baseline iron on a patient, you give them a single 325 milligram tablet of ferrous sulfate, which has got about 65 milligrams of iron in it, and the serum iron should increase by over 100 micrograms per DL. So that would prove that the patient is indeed capable or not of absorbing iron. So that's a kind of a nice test to know about, both clinically and potentially on the test as well. Now, about an hour later, it's fairly quick. Yeah, she asked, how long do you clean? It's about an hour later, plus or minus maybe a half hour or so. Anemia of chronic disease is the most common cause of normocytic anemia, aside from acute blood loss, which is usually pretty obvious to us. It is associated with chronic inflammatory and infectious conditions, in addition to neoplastic disorders, but apparently some statistics show that it can occur if there's no obvious chronic disease going on. Obviously, in that situation, a little bit more work's going to need to be done to determine that indeed is the case. The pathophysiology of this is because you've got decreased iron availability because of decreased absorption. The macrophages don't release the iron for reutilization. You've got decreased erythropoietin. The span of the RBC is slightly decreased as well. And that's why we get anemia with chronic disease, because it has an effect on all phases of iron, both absorption and utilization. A good pearl here is that about 20 to 30, 40% of the time, anemia of chronic disease can be associated with a low MCV. And, you know, I don't know if it's easy to remember or not, but rarely is the MCV less than 72 unless you've got a concomitant iron deficiency as well. So it does cross over, if you will, between normocytic and microcytic indices. Now, in terms of iron regulation, all of us store, if we're not deficient, between 2.5 and 4 grams of iron in our bodies. And we really have no good way of getting rid of it, aside from, you know, in women who menstruate, and then we lose a little bit of iron in our stool. Everybody's got a little bit of blood in their stool occasionally, and you've also got, you know, shedding of skin, and if sweat has a little bit of iron in it as well. But there's really no well-oiled and well-organized way for us to actually eliminate iron from our body. But we do have a fairly highly regulated absorption process, which replaces the 1 to 1.5 milligrams that we typically use on a daily basis. I've already covered this bullet right here. And so really, the issue we're dancing around right now is this whole idea of iron overload. Because people who require chronic transfusions are at risk for iron overload. People who've got hemochromatosis, which is the next slide, are at risk for iron overload. And people who've got ineffective erythropoiesis due to thalassemias and the like are also at risk for iron overload. So hemochromatosis really is a subset of iron overload, which is an autosomal recessive condition. It's most common in Caucasians, uncommon in people of color, and typically occurs in 1 to 200 Caucasians. And there, you know, some statistics, or maybe it is the statistic, that suggests it's one of the most common genetic disorders that we will see. And I'm guessing many of us, including myself, probably missed this on occasion. Now, here's the cue. The hemoglobin is normal. These people are not polycythemic. Their hemoglobin does not get to 17, 18, 19, like you might see with polycythemia vera, but they have a persistently high transferrin saturation index. That's that iron over the TIBC, typically greater than 45 in women and 50 in men. And the serum ferritin level, again, in the absence of an acute phase response, is always elevated. And sometimes it can be quite elevated, close to 1,000 or so. So those are going to be your cues to the presence of hemochromatosis, the elevated transferrin saturation index and the elevated ferritin in the absence of an acute phase response. Now, it's relatively easy to identify those who are a carrier. You get this HFE gene mutation, which apparently you just write on the lab slip when you're ordering it and it gets done. I have no idea how they actually do this or not, but it's present in about 90% of the patients who have hemochromatosis. Now, it's probable that on the test, they may give you a little bit of information about the iron binding capacity and the ferritin and the like, but more likely than not, they're going to give you a scenario in which you've got somebody coming in, for example, with otherwise unexplained liver disease or cirrhosis, and you got to work backwards. You know, they're going to give you the cues that they're not alcoholic and they don't have any autoimmune processes going on, they haven't been exposed to viruses and the like. So about 75% of the time, hemochromatosis is going to present with an otherwise unexplained liver disease. Less frequently, you can see the so-called bronze diabetes. You can get infiltration into the heart that leads to heart failure. Some of these patients develop problems in their joints leading to arthritis, weakness, a very nonspecific symptom, and skin pigmentation due to iron deposition in the skin are also associated with this. But I'd bet a lot of money that if they test you on this on the test, they're really going to give you somebody who has an otherwise unexplained problem with their liver, usually elevated transaminases. When would you consider a liver biopsy? Well, really, liver biopsy, if the ferritin's greater than 100 or there's persistently abnormal liver function testing, because if cirrhosis is present, like anybody with cirrhosis, hepatitis C, alcoholism, and the like, of course, their lifetime risk of getting hepatocellular carcinoma is not insubstantial, and so some screening mechanisms for that should be instituted. Since it is autosomal recessive, family members should be screened, and the treatment essentially is to get rid of iron. So the treatment is to phlebotomize people to a ferritin level of less than 20. So they typically will start getting phlebotomized 1 to 2 times per week until the iron levels develop, and then maintenance phlebotomy can occur, you know, obviously based upon the patient's response, once every 2 to 6 months or so. In terms of macrocytic anemia, I think it's slightly important to recognize the difference between macrocytic and megaloblastic. Macrocytic is the anemia that's associated with an elevated MCV, but the PMNs have normal number of lobes, whereas megaloblastic has more than 5 lobes on the PMN nuclei. Normal is 3 to 5. So the normal PMN nuclei have 3 to 5 lobes, greater than 5 lobes, and an elevated MCV qualifies as megaloblastic anemia. And the two biggest issues with regards to that would be B12 and folate deficiency, And apparently folate deficient, folate can be somewhat inhibited in terms of its absorption with metformin. So that's kind of a cue, perhaps not testable on the test, but maybe something to consider because this is such a commonly used drug for diabetes. In addition, bone marrow disorders, we'll talk a little bit later about myelodysplasia, that can also be associated with a macrocytic indices. And a certain number of drugs, perhaps ones that we might see more commonly, are patients who've got rheumatoid or on methotrexate, maybe people who've got inflammatory bowel disease on sulfasalazine and the like. So those would be some of the drugs to consider that can have an effect on the MCV. In terms of B12 deficiency, the biggest area that we're going to be probably considering this, and somebody who's got an otherwise unexplained peripheral neuropathy. They got numbness, tingling, all the things that you might see in somebody who's got a diet who's diabetic, but they're not diabetic. So this is clearly, we talked briefly yesterday about peripheral neuropathy in the neurology talk, would be one of your differential diagnoses for people presenting with neuropathic symptoms. Last case I was involved with about a year ago, we had a lady come into the hospital who stuck her tongue out and it was as red as anything. So she had an intense glossitis associated with her B12 deficiency. And you can see there's a whole host of other neurological symptoms that may be associated with it. But I think the peripheral neuropathy would probably be the biggest one that you'd be tested on. Now, we can easily order a B12 level. Now, the point of this second bullet is that a low normal B12 level does not rule out B12 deficiency. Because there is variability from day to day and lab to lab, et cetera, et cetera. So if you are concerned that a patient might have B12 deficiency and their level's 250, 220, 260, a recommendation is to order some of the intermediate metabolites, methylmalonic acid, which is MMA and homocysteine, because if both of those are elevated, that then is diagnostic, if you will, of B12 deficiency. So just recognize you may be tested on this, and the next step may be ordering MMA and homocysteine. We hardly ever order antibodies to intrinsic factor. That's associated with pernicious anemia. In some ways, it doesn't matter because it doesn't affect our treatment, because treatment is oral B12, because there's lots of other mechanisms for absorption of B12 aside from intrinsic factors and an intact ileum. So for the most part, the whole idea that people who've got B12 deficiency and specifically pernicious anemia need to be treated with parenteral B12 has been discredited. So oral B12 works quite well. Of course, we're giving people like 1,000 micrograms a day, so they're getting lots and lots of this in their supplement. Now, moving on to some of the hemolytic anemias, next six slides are going to be talking about hemolytic anemias. And the first category we'll talk about here is hereditary spherocytosis. Interestingly, this is the most common hereditary hemolytic anemia infancy to old age. I thought that was kind of an interesting concept. Obviously, if you make it to old age with hereditary spherocytosis, you got a pretty mild case. It is autosomally dominant, so it's obviously genetic, hereditary, as mentioned up there. These patients do have splenomegaly, jaundice, and commonly will develop bilirubin stones, leading to cholelithiasis, usually by the time they reach 30.